Patrick. Patrick Reynolds. My God. Grew up where?
Grew up in Miami and New York and a few New England boarding schools, Europe and so on.
Boarding schools. Had fun?
Not always.
Yeah? Which one?
Hotchkiss, Cranwell. Went to a number of them. A lot of people think I'm from North Carolina because, of course, that's where all the tobacco is grown. And
Patrick.
With my name being
Patrick
Reynolds.
Was it tough growing up as R.J. Reynolds'
grandson?
Miami
and New York
grandson.
And a few New England boarding schools, Europe in the summer. Sometimes.
Boarding schools.
Sometimes. But, you know, most of the time, I've had a very normal upbringing. Smiled and frowned at the same things as all the other kids.
Remember,
a lot of really, people. I wasn't really too aware of it.
Of course,
my mother, Marianne Reynolds. That's where all the tobacco was. Beautiful astrologer. My name being Reynolds.
Was it tough?
She didn't get as large a settlement in the divorce as the first wife had, for various and sundry reasons.
Sometimes,
so I grew
but,
up
know,
in
most
a
of the
fairly
time,
normal environment. A
lot
of people wonder, why I've gone against smoking and why
the same things.
I am the Reynolds, of course, who's
really,
been
right,
gone against the tobacco industry. And
my mother,
that is
Marianne,
the primary
Reynolds,
focus of my life,
was
fighting smoking
and
drugs.
And contract to Warner Brothers.
Is that the reason you wrote this book?
She didn't get as large a settlement in the divorce as the first wife.
Is that the reason you really wrote this book?
No, it's not. In fact, the book, The Gilded Leaf, tells the story of the R.J. Reynolds family.
A lot of people
without going into why I've gone against smoking. Tobacco industry and all I am the Reynolds, of course, is
that I
can't been gone against the tobacco industry
and getting smoking off planes,
which
focus
is finally
going to
happen on February 25th.
It is going to happen.
The book tells the story of the R.J. Reynolds family. The reason I wrote the book is because
really
I really didn't know my father. I didn't understand it. In fact, the book, The Gilded Leaf, tells the story of the R.J. Reynolds family. And
without going into
my father, R.J. Reynolds
Jr.,
the tobacco industry,
on a total of maybe six or seven occasions,
the issues that I can't
divorce,
when I
was clean indoor
air and getting smoking off planes.
And my only memories is finally going to happen on lying down on his back. Dying from
medication. The book tells the story of
cigarette
habits.
Family.
The reason I wrote the book is
smoking
the family brands, Camels and Winston.
I didn't understand.
That's
it.
Why I hate smoking.
I took my dad's inherited by him.
And that is why
I
wrote the book, because I didn't know him.
I only met my father
as a way of coming to terms with my anger toward my father.
Six or seven occasions after
my feelings of sadness at
his absence.
My only memories of him are of a man lying down on his back.
No, I'm dying.
I remember caused by his cigarette habit.
Oh, yes, you did smoke.
Smoking
oh,
yeah. The family
brand.
Dick Camels and
Winston.
That's why I
hate
smoking.
For the usual
reason.
Dad away from me.
And
that
is why
adolescent
rebellion
book,
because
I
didn't know
him.
Uh-huh.
Yeah,
it was a way of coming to terms with my anger
need
toward
to
my
attract
father.
Girls, my insecurities about that.
My feelings of sadness
and,
at his absence.
It sure was hard to stop. I mean, I really know firsthand how hard.
That's why I wrote the book.
How did Patrick
remember?
Did you smoke? I want to know.
When you were young?
Oh, yes.
Everyone in America
oh, yeah. I was an addicted smoker. I've started smoking for all the usual reasons. You know, the usual adolescent rebellion against authority. The usual, you know, need to attract girls, my insecurities about that.
And then later, 80% of all the
it sure was hard to stop. And I really know firsthand
the same rate of recidivism.
How did Patrick
stop? So my advice to people who
want
to quit, the way I quit,
because everyone in America is difficult
in life. Winners get help.
I can tell you my
people who win get help. A lawyer gets a call.
Well, the first thing I like to say is that
there are four out of five people who stop smoking, they do it on their own without being in a program.
Might even get a
and then later, 80% of all the people who quit go back to cigarettes. It's the same rate of recidivism as heroin. So my advice to people who want to quit, and the way I quit, was to get in a
program.
You know, in life, winners get help. People who win get help. A lawyer gets a a businessman gets a lawyer to write the contracts. He gets an accountant to do the accounting. He might even get a shrink to help him get along better with his wife and children. So winners get help in life, and that's good. I think people who want to quit should get in a program. I went through acupuncture, hypnosis, shock therapy, every program in the book, and one program I went through five times. Finally, I found one that I really like and that worked for me. Cybervision's How to Quit Smoking for Life. It's a pleasant, they're a firm based in Pleasanton, California, and they have a program consisting of 8 one-hour audio cassettes, and they're in the telephone book 800 information. Cybervision, S-Y-B-E-R, vision.
Does Patrick Reynolds have guilt? You seem like you have a lot of guilt. Is there a lot of guilt?
I don't think too much. I try to throw guilt out the window. I think, you know, if I stop for a minute and thought about all the many millions of people who had died because of the product my grandfather, R.J. Reynolds, helped popularize, I would be paralyzed. I wouldn't be able to move in present time.
Patrick, there are people 90 years old still smoking cigarettes. 90. I know some Southerners out there. They constantly smoke. I mean, you cannot just blame it on cigarettes. Do you really blame it on cigarettes?
And homicide.
I mean,
you put all those together and add on 50% to the number. That's what how many cigarettes. No, naturally. And while the tobacco industry has claimed that it's never been proven that cigarettes cause disease, the fact is The overwhelming medical evidence is in. Cigarettes do cause disease. Tobacco companies are lying. And
I want to show this picture. This is R.J. Reynolds and his family?
That's
sure.
How many
cigarettes. May I show this?
Of course.
And, now, show me. Who is R.J. Reynolds?
The older claim that it's never been proven that cigarettes cause disease. And the fact is, the overwhelming medical evidence is in. Cigarettes do cause disease. Tobacco companies are lying. And, they kill.
I want to show this picture. This is R.J. Reynolds and his family?
Sure.
May I show this?
Of course.
Now, show me. Who is R.J. Reynolds?
The older, the older man is my grandfather, R.J.
Uh-huh.
And there's my grandmother, Catherine.
Right.
Who was about 20 or 30 years his junior. Now, here there are four children. My father, the oldest one, R.J. Reynolds, Jr.
Mm-hmm.
And there was my Aunt Nancy. And there's my Aunt Mary. And my Uncle Smith. And, you know, R.J. chewed tobacco. And he died of cancer of the pancreas, which may have been caused by his chewing tobacco.
Uh-huh.
My father, R.J. Reynolds, Jr., smoked the family brands, and
uh-huh.
he died of emphysema.
Uh-huh.
Aunt Mary and Aunt Nancy smoked, and they died of emphysema and
now,
cancer.
Now, show me, who is R.J.
So
Reynolds?
So, cigarettes have decimated the entire Reynolds family. They've taken most of my family away from me. And people ask, why do I fight the tobacco industry? I think it's time a Reynolds came out and spoke the truth about smoking, and that's why I campaigned for the many issues I'm
How about the other Reynolds? Are they upset about this?
Some of them are very upset about it, sure. My cousins,
uh-huh.
my cousin Smith in Washington,
right.
And he's very unhappy.
Is he?
Threatened to sue over, you know, didn't like, hated the book, thought it was outrageous, thought the book was full of things I shouldn't put in there. I had to come to terms with my feelings, my anger about the family, and my strong feelings of alienation.
But you made him look like he was a real playboy of the century, I mean, he was.
People ask, why do I fight
women?
The tobacco industry?
I
think it's time. Yes. My father, he was.
Was he really?
He was the quintessential playboy of the 1920s.
How about
the
other
girls in the speakeasies? He was.
Some of them were very upset.
Running around on his yachts, he pulled his own disappearing act like Huckleberry Finn.
Right.
He built vast estates, threatened to sue over
parties all the time.
Hated the book. And you know, he partied pretty heavily. When he was sober, of course, it was the time of aviation and Lindbergh
about the family.
You know, there's R.J. My father, you know, flying his planes around in the daytime, but by the evening.
Looked
he was
like
too drunk,
was
and he killed him while driving
playboy
drunk
of
in England.
The century.
He did.
I mean,
sure, it's a very colorful story. His younger brother Smith,
loose women.
My uncle Smith was married to Libby Holman.
Yes. My father,
right.
He was.
And one night,
was
Smith
really?
Was found
was
alone
the
in, you know,
the
in the room.
Squire
was
been
alone in the room with Libby when the gun went off.
And a bullet
running around his yacht. To this day, it's never been proved whether it was a murder or a suicide.
He
but you know, all of that aside, my concerns today are
really more area.
You know, he partied pretty heavily. When he was sober, of course, it was the time of
aviation and the tobacco industry.
You know, there's R.J., my father, you know, flying his planes around in the daytime. But by the evening, he was too drunk, and he killed him while driving
drunk in
England.
They began an aggressive marketing.
Sure, it's a very colorful story. His younger brother,
American
Smith,
cigarette
my uncle Smith was married to Libby Holman, a torch singer,
in the Third World
War. One night, Smith was found alone, and since 1968,
according to the World
War, he'd been alone in the room with Libby when the gun went off.
Well, it's decreased in America.
To this day, it's never proved whether it was a murder or a suicide.
In China,
but you know, all of that aside, my
year.
Concerns
R.J.
today
Reynolds
are really
more
new
in the area
in China of
are
the tobacco
really?
Companies.
Yeah,
I'm concerned, for example,
that
Asians
know,
are getting the impression
industry.
Of we Americans
saw
these seeing
handwriting on the
wall
huge
in the
vast billboard campaign.
Right.
They began
as the
Surgeon General's first report came out. They began an aggressive marketing
and
advertising drive.
These people export
American cigarette brands and advertise them aggressively. In the Third World,
and they're
the
getting addicted by the millions.
And since 1968,
and right now there's
the
2 to 3 million
deaths
smoking
worldwide.
Smoking.
Well,
that's
decreased in America.
Has sharply
increased. 73%. In China, cigarette smoking is
probably
growing at
the greatest
9%
a year.
One of
the greatest.
R.J. Reynolds just opened a new plant in China.
The
tobacco companies.
Hundreds of,
yeah,
done, and
hundreds
of millions
of
Asians. Are getting the impression that we Americans, seeing all those
this
huge, vast
in
billboard campaigns
right.
in
Asia,
as a people that doesn't care about their health or
any
much of their
money,
and these people know little about the health consequences of smoking, many of them do, and they're getting addicted by the millions. And right now there's 2 to 3 million deaths a year worldwide from smoking, but that number is projected to sharply increase in coming years because of all the recently addicted millions. It is probably the greatest crime. One of the greatest crimes of the 20th century, what the tobacco companies have done. And we need to find some way to limit the export and advertising of U.S. cigarette brands in the Third World and in Asia. It's critically important to our image abroad and to saving lives.
What should we do then?
Well, perhaps propose an export tax. At the very least, insist that warning labels be put on the packs in all the foreign countries. Very often, we don't even put warning labels on U.S. cigarette brands. in foreign countries. We have one set of standards for ourselves and another set of standards for foreign peoples, and this is shocking. Advertising in America, for example. Moving on to a second topic, right. Advertising is, cigarettes are the most heavily advertised product in America today.
Uh-huh.
They're spending more money advertising cigarettes than any other product. Around $10 a head for every man, woman, and child in this country to advertise a product that these executives know is killing millions of people. And it's staggering to see what is going on in that area.
What happened to all the millions to this cause?
Right.
And I feel so strongly about what he said, particularly about his father, because my husband died of emphysema.
He did?
Uh-huh. 3 years ago. And so I know whereof you speak. It was dreadful because, as you know, emphysema is such an insidious disease. It takes a long time, and it works its terrible ways. And I always felt so guilty because I always felt if I had said the right thing or if I had been able to get him to stop smoking, why couldn't I get him to stop? And I never could. I mean, I dragged him to hypnotists
and
smoke enders and, you know, everything imaginable. No, he smoked Marlboro.
Marlboro.
Sure.
But
my
it doesn't matter, I don't think.
My father smoked Camels. He died of emphysema, too. I didn't want to tell you that, but he did.
No kidding.
Yes, he did. And go ahead.
It takes around 30 years on the average for, I'm very sorry about your husband, I'm sorry about your dad.
That's right. No, that's right. But
we share that.
Three packs a day. Three packs a day.
It takes around 30 years on the average from the time you start smoking and the time you start getting the disease. And, of course, whether it be heart disease or lung disease or emphysema or cancer. The fact is that 90% of all people who smoke have cemented in their nicotine addiction before even reaching the age of 20 years old. So the fact is that I have called for a law which would ban the sale of cigarettes to anyone under the age of 21. There should be a photo ID required to buy cigarettes. There should be severe penalties to merchants caught selling to minors. We need the same laws that now apply to the sale of alcohol in the States to now apply to the sale of cigarettes. We really need to start taking it seriously. Advertising is one reason we don't take it very seriously. And I think that when you realize that it's children, like in their mid-teens, that are first experimenting and starting smoking, and then they are already addicted to a product we know is addicting as heroin before even reaching the age of 20. That is why I'm so angry at the tobacco companies. They are that
father
had smooth
character,
cartoon figures. Advertising Camel cigarettes is an insidious piece of advertising, really aimed directly at teenagers.
Yes.
And moreover, it's appealing to children. So this kind of thing has to be stopped. We need to ban cigarette advertising altogether. And I am fighting it.
When he was sober, of course, it was the
foundation for a smoke-free America.
Smoke-free
America. Yes, and Patrick, flying his planes around in the daytime.
But by the evening, he was too drunk. So he killed him and he was driving drunk in England.
And I'm grateful for that. It's a very colorful story. His younger brother, Smith, meet all the support. Michael Smith was married to Libby
Coleman. Robert Carroll, you've worked nightclubs, playing the piano, singing, jazz,
everything.
You're a jazz.
All that good stuff. He's been alone in the room with Libby and the gunman.
Well, I've been doing it forever.
To this day, it's never been proved whether it was a murder or a suicide.
I'm from Worcester, Massachusetts.
But, all of that aside, my concerns today are really more in the area of the tobacco companies. I'm concerned, for example, that the tobacco industry, when it saw the handwriting on the wall in the 1960s, they began
when
the Surgeon General's first report came out, they began an aggressive marketing and advertising drive to export American cigarette brands and advertise them aggressively in the Third World and the Far East.
Is there?
And since 1968,
there is, and it's a new vogue.
Tell me where
people are going.
You tell me
while it's decreased in America,
has increased 73%. In China, cigarette smoking is growing at a rate of 9% a year.
R.J. Reynolds just opened a new plant in China.
Do they really?
And hundreds of millions of Asians are getting the impression that we Americans, seeing all those huge, vast billboard campaigns, as a people that doesn't care about their health and only wants their money.
These
people know little about the health consequences of smoking. Many of them do. And they're getting indulged by the millions.
It's not a new fashion.
And right now there's 2 to 3 million deaths a year worldwide from smoking.
In New York City.
But that number is projected to sharply increase in coming years because of all the recently addicted millions. It is probably the greatest crime, one of the greatest crimes of the 20th century, the tobacco companies have done. And we need to find some way to limit the export and advertising of U.S. cigarette brands in the Third World and in Asia. It's critically important to our image abroad and to saving lives. Well, perhaps propose an export tax, at the very least, insist that warning labels be put on the packs in all the foreign countries. Very often, we're not, we don't even put warning labels on U.S. cigarette brands in foreign countries. We have one set of standards for ourselves and another set of standards for foreign peoples, and this is shocking. Advertising in America, for example, moving on to a second topic, advertising is, cigarettes are the most heavily advertised product in America today.
We're
spending more money advertising cigarettes than any other product. Around $10 a head for every man, woman, and child in this country to advertise a product that these executives know is killing millions of people. And it's staggering to see what is going on in that area.
What happened to all the millions that Reynolds, your grandfather, spent? I mean, spent it all? Did you get any? You got some.
Well, that story we tell in The Gilded Leaf.
In The Gilded Leaf?
Yes, I got
but
some.
But you
of
just sold this book out. I mean, this book is sold out, Brent, in fact.
It's sold out. You can go to a bookstore and order it.
And order it?
Sure.
Boy, I tell you, this book really... Did you read this? Barbara, how are you?
Hello.
I saw your performance last night at the Westwood.
I'm glad. I might sound like a name dropper. Yes, I will.
That's okay. Barbara is.
She's never like Gloria Vanderbilt. Did you ever see her work?
At the
Bellamy Bar at the Carlisle like that.
So you become friends with these people.
Sure, you're very well known.
Yes. Well, I'm so
Patrick,
the
Surgeon General, looks up. Honored to giving you a great applause in Washington, D.C.
Yeah, he
loves Patrick Reynolds for what you're doing.
Yeah,
tell me about
you.
It. You become good friends.
Well, I'm very fond of the Surgeon General. I admire him, you know, and he's made such an impact and been such a leader and courageous in the face of a lot of opposition politically. He's called my work invaluable to our society. I've also got an honor from the United Nations, the World Health Organization.
How nice.
And I've been given the Humanitarian of the Year Award from Mount Sinai Hospital in Chicago, and many other awards from
so
the
So Patrick is not doing it just for the money. There you, Patrick.
Well, there's
a lot
no
of people out there think you are doing it for the money.
Well, there's no money in it, really. You know, I don't get a salary from my foundation.
No,
I don't. We're a non-profit charitable group.
Right.
In fact, we even have our tax exemption from the IRS and the state of California, so I'm real happy about that. Oh.
I'd love to show this lovely lady. This lady, Robert Carroll,
is
Patrick Reynolds' mother. Isn't she beautiful?
Oh, nice.
Isn't she lovely? Well,
there she is in a publicity shot for Warner Brothers during the early 40s, just before she met my father. She was an actress under contract to Warner Brothers. Mm-hmm. Her name was Marianne O'Brien, and she appeared in movies like The Very Thought of You and Hollywood Canteen.
Mary O'Brien was your mother, Patrick?
Marianne O'Brien was my mom, and
I
she was great.
I know this.
She was one of those larger-than-life people, very loved
and
by...
And here's your dad?
Later in life.
Later in life.
Dying from emphysema with his oxygen bottle. At the
that
ready.
That looks so familiar to me.
His lawyer in the background, and now divorcing his third wife, about to move on to his fourth wife. My mom was his second wife, and he was increasingly bitter at the end of his life toward people that wanted him for his money. And, you know, it's a mystery whether he left all of his money to his last wife in a mysterious handwritten will that, you know, we don't know whether it was his will or not. It's all in my book, The Gilded Leaf.
Here is your friend.
There's Dr. Koob.
Dr. Koob.
His nickname is, we call him Chick.
Oh, he's so terrific.
He is, isn't
the
he?
Things that he has done, the stands that he has taken, not only on smoking, but on abortion and on all kinds of AIDS.
Yeah.
AIDS, yes.
I mean, he single-handedly has come out for all the right causes.
No, the guy is terrific. He's really one of the great leaders of the 20th century.
But what is he going to do now that he's no longer Surgeon General? Is
well,
he still going to be vocal and active and be able to pursue all these good causes?
Oh, yes. And I want to point out that at the top of his agenda in the tobacco area, the very top issue for which he campaigns, and myself also, is the export of tobacco to foreign countries that I was talking about earlier.
Right.
I mean, imagine a 73% increase in smoking around the world since 1968. And it's because we've allowed the U.S. Not only to advertise and market aggressively in those countries, but also to our government, our very trade office in Washington, has been pressuring governments to lower their trade barriers against U.S. cigarettes. Mm-hmm. We have the government in the United States helping to export death from America.
Mm-hmm. Barbara, favorite song?
Favorite song?
Yes.
Oh,
you must have.
How can I choose?
Several, but what is?
Well, I suppose if I had to name one, it might be "All the Things You Are." excuse me, Jerome Kern. Because I think that's the greatest, one of the greatest combinations of music and lyrics, which were written by Oscar Hammerstein.
They call you a jazz pianist. Jazz? Is it jazz?
Well, that's because...
Last night you didn't do jazz.
Well, it all depends upon what you think jazz is.
Oh, okay.
I think that one of the components of jazz is improvisation, and I'm constantly improvising.
True. I see.
I think I maybe see. Some people think of jazz as being loud and raucous and with a very heavy rhythmic a percussion kind of driving force going. But since I'm working alone, I don't have that.
Does Barbara Carroll write songs?
Yes, I do.
You do?
Yes.
You do your own little material?
So I do.
You do?
Indeed. One of my compositions is in my new album.
Patrick Reynolds, actor. You were an actor for a while.
Before I became an anti-smoking leader, I was an actor. That's true.
Really?
And those skills have come in real handy. I starred in a movie that's out on video, actually. Nobody knows about it.
Good-looking guy, isn't he, Robert?
Indeed.
I play a robot in that movie. And,
really?
Yeah, it was metal from the neck down, and I got to say dialogue like, "You're the one who needs body work." And then my name was Mandroid, and a film called Eliminators.
Okay.
Yeah, and, not to be confused with Annihilator or Exterminator.
Does Patrick Reynolds sing?
I did, actually, yes.
Did you really?
Yeah, I studied for 2 years. I recorded 3 singles and trained my voice. And
interesting.
Those things have come in handy now in my present work, which is lecturing. I lecture at universities and so on, and lecture at...
You enjoy lecturing.
Before medical groups, and sure. And wherever I go, it's fun. You know, the local media always turn out. We get to, you know, a couple of network affiliate news crews and, you know, get in the local paper. And, you know, I'm wonderful public relations for the groups that have been hiring me, mainly hospital groups and medical groups.
You're a family man.
Yeah.
Basically, you're a family man. I see you here with your brothers.
That's right.
This
oh,
is your
I'm
brother.
Glad you showed the picture. You know, a lot of people think I can't go home. You know, he's Reynolds. They must hate him. He gave up his family. No, there's my brother Mike and his wife Gail and their daughter, and I'm home. And I was home with them for Christmas this year, and we had a lovely time together.
Did you really?
Yeah, and then I went home to see my other brother, Josh, in North Carolina, R.J. Reynolds III. He used to hang around New York, and he was...
Is he wild?
Oh,
no.
My wild brother was Zach, and Zach was killed in 1979. He had the largest collection of motorcycles in the world, the largest ham radio station. Zach was a hot-blooded wild man, and we tell his whole life story, along with my own life story, at the very end of The Gilded Leaf. He was an eccentric who predicted his own death in a plane crash. He said, "I'm going to die in a plane crash." Talk with the North Carolina accent.
Looking back, Patrick, would you like to be called self Patrick Reynolds? I meant
Patrick Reynolds. Would you
like to have been someone else instead of Patrick Reynolds? Being a wealthy boy growing up and father not knowing your dad.
I would have liked to have had my dad there, and I would have liked to have had a few things different. But I think, all in all, I'm not going to trade places, you know, with anybody. I enjoy my life. There's been some sadness and there's been some dysfunction in my family.
Right.
And, you know, in fact, by the way, I've started attending Adult Children of Alcoholics, which is a wonderful thing, and I don't share that very often in public. But ACA is a wonderful way. If you've had a divorce in your family, you don't have to be the child of an alcoholic. It's a movement that's starting to sweep America, and, you know, people are going there to get in touch with their sadness and their anger about their childhoods and their families. Mm-hmm. And it's free. It doesn't cost any money. And you could call Alcoholics Anonymous and find out where the local Adult Children of Alcoholics or ACA groups are in your community. It's sweeping the country, and it's free, and it's done me a lot of good. I've enjoyed
it. That sounds like a wonderful
there.
Thing that many people could benefit by.
Sure. In fact, they say that more than half of the families in this country are
you
dysfunctional.
You think you're going to stop everybody trying to smoke cigarettes in this world? I mean, people, you cannot tell people what they should do. I don't know why. I mean, if people want to smoke, Patrick or Robert, they've got to smoke. You cannot just, you know what happened to me? I was on a ship on the Queen Mary, the last voyage, and I took my Dunhill and Kent cigarettes, and I threw them overboard, and I never touched, I made my own mind, my own decision. Didn't listen to anybody.
Well, so did I. I smoked for many, many years. I started when I was 14. And I smoked until about 1975. I smoked for a very long time, and I smoked constantly. I mean, I never thought I could live without smoking.
Most people do. I mean, 4 out of 5 smokers quit on their own like that. But then later, 80% of them go back to smoking. And most people who quit successfully have to try an average of about 3 times before they finally quit for good.
Uh-huh.
So I think getting in a program is still the best way to go. And your local branch of the American Lung
Americans
Association.
Americans all want to get on programs. Mm-hmm. I don't know why. I mean, why should Americans get on? Oh, they always want to get on the bandwagon and just boom, boom. I don't know. Anyway.
Well, I didn't do it that way. I just tapered off.
I
decided I would not buy cigarettes.
Me too.
So I just sort of bummed them from everybody else.
But I love what Patrick Reynolds is doing, though.
I still say call the American Cancer Society and get help.
Yeah, is that it? Westwood Marquee.
Yes. I will be there for 6 weeks. I opened last night. So.
6 weeks.
I'll be there till February 17th. Long engagement.
Yes, it is.
Come back again.
Who was there last night? Some of the stars were there. I just saw Luann Sims last night.
Luann Sims was there, yes.
From the Hit Parade.
Yes.
She's the old darling lady, I saw.
Yes, the wonderful young man who played Rock Hudson in the Rock Hudson story was there.
Uh-huh.
And
I didn't see them.
Yes, Joanna Carson was there, a whole bunch of people.
So you had a good opening.
That was fun. We had a great time.
So how much, what's your session like? How long do you play?
I start at 9.
One night or just, I mean, one performance?
No,
or?
No, I do about three during the evening. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. But it's quite informal.
Three performances?
Yes, uh-huh. Yes.
Oh, they work me like crazy.
Well, how long is your set?
That's
as long as I want it to be, anywhere from 45 minutes to an hour maybe. Uh-huh. It's fun. I have a great time.
Wow.
But Carlisle, tell me about the Hotel Carlisle. Such a great hotel.
The Hotel Carlisle is a very special place, as you know. Uh-huh. It's a five-star hotel. It's low-key. It's beautiful. It's very private, so the people who stay there can stay there and feel that not everyone's going to know that they're there and won't care if they're there.
Yes.
Yeah, my mother used to stay there, actually.
Did she?
Yeah, she did. Yeah.
And it's privately owned, you see. It's not a chain hotel, so I think that makes a great deal of difference.
Patrick Reynolds, would you like to be an actor again? Come on.
Well, I have an agent who's...
Because you're getting on TV all the time. Every time I turn television on, you're on. You're on the Donahue Show. You're on all those
shows. I've actually had an agent call me and wants to send me out. So I sent him over,
I think you're a great
touch.
I think you should go.
And I'm not pushing it real hard, but I think, if there's a way of helping me get my message across and do what I do even better, sure, it's a good idea.
Look at this. You're on the cover of...
I'm on the cover of a magazine called Hardcore.
Wow.
It's a new magazine, and I'm also on the cover of another one this month.
It's East West. What's this all about? Yeah. My God, you're hitting all the covers.
I've got two current magazine covers. It's pretty amazing. There's John Robbins, who's the Baskin-Robbins who went against the ice cream industry.
Right.
And he was a vegetarian now and doesn't like... he says that John is wonderful. He wrote a wonderful book and points out that it takes like 16 pounds of grains to make 1 pound of meat.
Uh-huh.
And if we just cut our meat consumption by 10%, we would have enough grains to feed the whole planet.
He's right.
No, I'm in favor of
I'm
that.
I'm a favor because I don't eat meat at all.
I don't
all.
Either.
I don't eat meat at all. And I liked him. I saw him on that show. Yeah. I thought he was wonderful. He looked great, looked thin. He looks wonderful. How many years you haven't touched a cigarette?
Oh, Lord. It's been since, 5 years. Almost five years.
Five.
And I, knock on wood, I'm so happy and grateful. And I just know that I'll never go back. My secret for staying off and how I've managed to do that is that I realized that I can't have just one cigarette. And I noticed that it was always in moments of negative stress, in an argument with my ex-wife, who's a lovely lady now, and we're friends, or in a sad moment or a lonely moment, or in a happy moment. When I'm out on vacation, I'm with friends, and the espresso comes after a wonderful five-star meal, and some friend of mine will pull out a cigarette, usually a European, and I'll say, give me a cigarette now, and thinking I can have one. I haven't had one in several months or a year or something. I can have just one, and a dozen times I went back to smoking in that very way. So now, when I'm out to dinner with the friends, and the espresso comes, and the friend pulls out the cigarette, I go.